Hey guys, welcome to all of you on our channel. So how are you? I hope you are doing well. So friends, as you know that on our channel we are targeting the exam of civil services, and for that purpose we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So one of these series is about solving daily some questions for prelims 2020. So the name of this series is Let's Solve Some Questions for Prelims 2020. So this video is 22 of this series. So as is clear from it, the name of this series is not just about solving questions, but it is also about your participation. So we do expect that you people will participate in the discussion in the comment box. So we expect that if you have any additional information apart from the explanations that are provided by us for the questions, then do share with us in the comment box. So let's start our discussion, friends. So today we will be discussing the questions from Indian polity. So let's see the questions. The first question is, the central government has a constitutional duty to protect states against first external aggression and internal disturbance, second failure of constitutional machinery. So we have to choose the correct answer. So this question is quite easy. So the answer is C, that is both 1 and 2. So central government has constitutional duty to both protect the states against the external aggression as well as in case of failure of constitutional machinery. So basically under there is a provision under Article 355 of the Constitution which says that it shall be the duty of the Union to protect every state against external aggression and internal disturbance and to ensure that the government of every state is carried on in accordance with the provisions of this Constitution. So then President rule is applied under Article 356 in this case. So it can be applied also when the state government has willfully disobeyed the directions of the central government and disturbed the constitutional distribution of executive power. So this was your first question. Let's move on to the next question. Next is, the sovereignty of India means, first, no external power can dictate the government of India. Second, the citizens cannot be discriminated against on any grounds. Third, there is absolute freedom of speech and expression for Indian citizens. Fourth, all citizens have equal economic rights. So we have to choose the correct answer. So many of you people will be confused, but let me tell you that the answer is only one, that is B, one only. So though third and fourth, second thing is there, that citizens cannot be discriminated against certain grounds, but not on any grounds. There are certain grounds on which they cannot be discriminated. So then also this, but citizens have equal economic rights, but in case of three, the citizens of India do not have absolute freedom of speech and expression, but it is qualified and certain restrictions are there in place. So sovereignty is only related to first statement, that is no external power can dictate the government of India. So simply, sovereignty simply implies that India is a state that takes its own decisions, ultimately guided by the people. So no external agency dictates terms to India. So one is correct. So however, the notion of sovereignty does not seep into the framework of all democratic rights. For example, sovereign state might very well discriminate between citizens. For example, Pakistan does with all non-Muslims. So in this case, the context is particularly such type that this question is has become quite controversial, but I will not go into the controversy, so I will restrict myself. So if we go by literal sense, that then India does not discriminate against any person on the certain grounds. So then third statement is, same applies for freedom of speech and expression, so it is not absolute. And also sovereign state, it may be very well possible that for example China is a sovereign state, so it can may very well restrict freedom of speech. So it has in fact stringent restrictions there, and it is also not even absolute in Indian context. It is qualified, so even though it is very vital to a democracy. And then statement four is, only possible when there is an economic democracy. So the answer is B. Now let's move to the next question. Next is, which of the following types of bills can be passed in joint sitting of the parliament? A, constitutional amendment bill, B, money bill, C, ordinary bill, D, any of the above. So friends, let me tell you, friends, A cannot be the answer because constitutional amendment bills, they are required to be passed by each house of parliament separately, and then this money bill is not to be required to be passed by Rajya Sabha. So only one bill is left, and that is C, that is ordinary bills can be passed by joint sitting of the parliament. So the answer is C, ordinary bill. So any ordinary law needs to be passed by both houses of the parliament, but if in case there is a difference between the two houses, then the final decision is taken in a joint session in which members of both houses sit together. Because of the larger number of members, the view of the Lok Sabha is likely to prevail, so in such a meeting. But Lok Sabha exercises more powers in money matters. So once the Lok Sabha passes the budget of the government or any other money related law, the Rajya Sabha cannot reject it. It has merely 14 days, it can only delay it by 14 days or suggest changes in it. So Lok Sabha may or may not accept these changes. So there is no provision for joint sitting in such cases. Moreover, it is not required because Rajya Sabha cannot reject it. So if it doesn't respond within 14 days, then the bill is seemed to have been we can say approved by the Rajya Sabha in the form sent to the house to the Rajya Sabha. But if in any case if any suggestions are prescribed by Rajya Sabha, but in case of money bills, that don't matter. So government may or may not consider those suggestions, and Lok Sabha can pass it with or without the changes that are suggested by Rajya Sabha. So now let's move on to the next question. Next is, consider the following statements about village administration. First, Patwari's main work is the measurement of land and keeping land records. Second, Patwari is responsible for conducting census and issuing caste and birth certificates in a village. Third, land disputes in a village are to be officially heard and settled by a Patwari. So we have to choose the correct answer. So friends, here only one statement is correct, that is first. So the answer is A, because this Patwari is not responsible for conducting census, and caste and birth certificates are in fact issued by the tehsildar, and then land disputes in the village are not heard and settled by Patwari. So that these are basically civil disputes. So most often village communities do try to solve them on their own basis, but when the situation goes out of hand, then such cases come in the court of law. So the answer is one only. So then also this land disputes can also be decided by the tehsildar's office. So they supervise the work of Patwaris, and then Patwari is known by different names in different states. For example, in some villages such officers are called Lekhpal, and then in others they are called Kanugo or Karamchari or village officer. So each Patwari is responsible for a group of villages. The Patwari maintains and updates the records of the village. So these certificates are usually the certificates which are talked about in the statement. So these certificates are usually issued at higher levels, such as block or district administration. So Patwari comes at the village level or a village group level. So statement 3 is that the tehsildar office is where the land disputes are heard. So they supervise the work of Patwaris. Now let's move on to the next question. Next is, consider the following statements about Election Commission of India. First, Election Commission of India is the only authority that can grant national party or state party status to a political party in India. Second, the election symbols, reservation and allotment order is issued by Election Commission of India and can be modified by it. So we have to choose the correct answer. So friends, let me tell you that both of these statements are correct. So answer will be C, that is both 1 and 2. So it is the Election Commission of India that gives the national party or state party status to a particular political party in India. So election symbol are also issued by Election Commission of India and can be modified by it. So solution is C. So a party is eligible to get national party status if it secures at least 6% of the valid votes polled in any 4 or more states in the Lok Sabha election or the state legislative assembly, and in addition it wins at least 4 seats in Lok Sabha from any states or state of states. So if also it wins at least 2% seats in the Lok Sabha, 11 seats in the existing Lok Sabha having 543 members, and these members are elected from at least 3 different states. So it is recognized as a state party in at least 4 states. So then in August 2016, Election Commission of India had brought changes in paragraph 6C of the Election Symbols Order 1966-68. So also more often these changes are being brought. So this is about your more is that recognition as a national state party ensures that the election symbol of that party is not used by any other political entity in polls across India. So other registered but unrecognized political parties have to choose choose from a pool of free symbols announced by the commission from time to time. So besides, these parties get land or buildings from the government to set up their party offices. They can come can have up to 40 star campaigners during electioneering. Others can have up to 20 star campaigners. So these are the details about this question, and this is all about today's discussion. So friends, if your score is 5 out of 5, then it is very good. But if your score is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, then it is very, very, very much good, because at least you have learned something today. You have learned something new. You have come across new facts and new concepts. So don't count your score. Why I have only said that 5 out of 5? Because ultimately that doesn't matter how much you score at this point of time. What will matter is that how you perform in real-time exam. So this video you can take not as a test of yourself, but as a mode through which you can improve yourself. You can learn something new daily. You can learn some new concepts, because ultimately it is, first of all, you must improve yourself by seeing how the questions come in UPSC, and how the questions are to be prepared, and how the questions are to be have to be solved. So counting score is doesn't matter. And why I have counted the scores, this is particularly the reason due to which, because I wanted to explain that it is not advisable to you to count your scores, because take this as just a way of improving yourself. So slowly and slow and gradual process will certainly take you a great deal ahead, because the small steps ultimately result in the completion of the journey. So this is about today's video. And friends, you might be aware of the fact that we have various series for the purpose of CSE preparation. For example, we have A Brief History of Modern India by Spectrum Publications in 45 days. And then we have Geography NCRT series, and also we have Polity NCRT series, and Lakshmikanth NCRT series. And then we have not Lakshmikanth NCRT series, but basically it is M. Lakshmikanth's Indian Polity book. It is covered in 60 days. So all these series we have. For example, then we have Indian Economy series of the book that is of Ramesh Singh. So all these series are to basically ensure that there is at least you can ensure a discipline in your studies, and you can complete your syllabus in a time bound manner. So what we do in these series, we daily give you a target and the target is required to be read by you. Basically we tell you that okay, start read that much number of chapters today from the book. So in the evening you are given questions. So in this manner your syllabus is covered in a time bound manner, so that you people can complete your syllabus timely, because most of the students today prefer from home and they are not in metropolitan cities, and the main issue that they face is completion of syllabus in a time bound manner. So they face the problem of streamlining themselves. So these series are to ensure that you prepare in a daily target mode, so that in the evening you can attempt the questions based on the daily target. So how it benefits you, basically, obviously these books are foundations of UPSC preparation, if you might be aware of this fact. And also this ensures that the coverage of your entire syllabus will be through MCQ mode, and it will ensure discipline in your studies, because timely study will streamline study will ensure discipline. And you will be given a daily target which you will have to prepare in the evening. So you will be preparing daily target, and gradually you will be completing your whole syllabus. And also the problem of revising multiple sources will also be solved, because all important MCQs will be covered in these series, and explanations will be comprehensive. So particularly this problem of revision at the last minute makes you brings in new anxiety. So such type of questions and their MCQ and their explanations will ensure that you can revise in last minute through a comprehensive way. And also these books are, if you might be aware of the fact, that they are widely recommended by various topers, and also mere reading is not enough. So you must know how the questions are framed by UPSC, and this idea only comes when you solve the MCQs. So disciplined preparation gives you then much needed self-confidence, and also now is the best time to start and cover all the syllabus. So prelims is just 6 months away. So I hope that you might not be delaying the things. So if in case you are interested, then you can check the description box, because all the details are given there, links are given there. So the links of different series are there, so you can choose which series you want to join. And also friends, there is a request that in the description box, please do check our Telegram channel, its link, because on this Telegram channel we have more than 15,000 students that follow us, and they have access to various public resources that we share for the purpose of CSE preparation. For example, the discussion of today's MCQs will also be uploaded there in the PDF format. So if you want to download the PDFs and want to have access to various other resources, then you are more than welcome to join our Telegram channel. The link of it will be provided in the description box. So you can check the description box and can join our Telegram channel. So this is all about friends today's video. If you liked it, then do ensure that you like it, share it with your friends, and also ensure that you subscribe to our channel. So thank you friends, have a very nice day ahead.